Yes, so let's start the session on Apache Sqoop, which is used to get data from relational databases into SDFS. We can import data from relational databases to Sqoop and using Sqoop to SDFS, and we can export as well. So basically, whenever there is a need to handle relational kind of data or structured kind of data, we'll use a Sqoop for that. So the agenda of today's session is we are going to learn about what is Sqoop, what is the need of Sqoop, why we need Sqoop, and how Sqoop connects to a relational database with SDFS in a different manner. We can have a look at different import methods using page, using hive, using Edgebase, which is one of the non-relational database available in the Hadoop ecosystem. So we are having so much of data from different sources. We all have a discussion on the different sources of big data, like Twitter, like Facebook, right? So the traditional way of handling this kind of data in Apache Hadoop framework is that we will write a map and reduce program to handle. So earlier solution in this Hadoop arena, we are having a map reduce framework, in which we will write map and reduce depending on the input format. So this is the traditional approach in Hadoop. We normally do data processing using map reduce program. But we have seen that some of the users may not be aware, may not be very much comfortable with Java, or may not be very much comfortable with map reduce programming. For those, we were having Hive and Pig, so that the non-programmers can also utilize the power of Hadoop. So similarly, here in order to handle the relational databases, in order to transfer data between relational databases to Hadoop and Hadoop to any other structured database, we need one solution for all of them who are not very much comfortable in programming. So for all of them, we are having Sqoop. So Sqoop basically is a solution in which supports all of the RDBMS, which manage parallel execution of data, and which supports Hive imports and Edgebase imports as well. So these are the characteristics which we are looking for in a solution, and that solution is nothing but Sqoop. So we'll have all these characteristics in Sqoop. Sqoop will support all kind of RDBMS, and it supports for different type of imports like Hive import and Edgebase kind of import. So basically, if we talk about what is Sqoop, so Sqoop is a data export tool used for RDBMS and Hadoop ecosystem. Now, as I said, it is a tool to transfer data between RDBMS and Hadoop, and vice versa as well. Like, we can export data from Hadoop to any of the RDBMS. And basically, it is developed by Cloudera in initial days, and then published to Apache as Apache incubating project. And now, Sqoop is a production ready software. We are using Sqoop in different type of operations. And similar to Pig and Hive, Sqoop also internally generates map reduce code to transfer the data. So ultimately, Sqoop statements are also going to be converted into map reduce program, map reduce code, as we have seen in the Pig and Hive statements as well. Both were also like ultimately going to be converted into map reduce kind of code. So similar is the case with Sqoop. When we write any command, any statement in Sqoop, ultimately it will going to be converted into corresponding MapReduce code, and that will be ultimately like executed at Hadoop end. Now, Sqoop provides different type of data connectors so that we can connect to different traditional RDBMS. There are ranges of connectors available to connect Sqoop with traditional RDBMS, such as we are having connectors for MySQL, connectors for Oracle, for NoSQL database like Greenplum, we are having the connectors, Teradata, Netezza. So all of these databases, we are having connectors to connect with Sqoop. So this is same as we are aware about JDBC in Java. To connect a Java program with any of the database, we need connectors. So similar is the case with Sqoop as well. In order to transfer data between relational database and Hadoop, we need a Sqoop, and for operation of Sqoop, we need connectors. So various connectors are already available for Sqoop operations. Now this is the way basically Sqoop works. Sqoop imports, when we write commands in Sqoop, it will be converted into Sqoop jobs, which are nothing but map jobs and which operates on SDFS storage. Now if we talk about the statement, how it looks like we have seen the statements in Piglin, statements in Hive, which are very much similar to SQL statements. Now in Sqoop, we are having syntax, like there are flags apart from the command, there are flags, different flags available. So we'll have a look at different flags as well. But for the moment, let's consider one example, how Hadoop transfer data from and to MySQL to HDFS. Suppose we are having data in MySQL and we want to transfer the data into HDFS. Now how the command will look like? So for doing this, the transfer data between MySQL and HDFS, we'll write command something like Sqoop import, then we'll use one flag connect, then we have to provide the driver kind of thing, JDBC, MySQL, then the path, IP address or localhost, whatever, database name. Table is another flag in which we have to write the MySQL table name from which data is going to be captured from, username of MySQL and password. This command is easy to understand, I think, David. Self-explanatory command is there. There are different flags and we have to provide different parameters, like we need to provide the driver, we need to provide the table name, the user ID and password. These are the parameters we need in Java JDBC code as well. You might be aware, right?
Yes.
In JDBC we need these kind of parameters to connect to a database.
Yeah. So can this be done only using Java?
Sorry?
Can this be done only using Java?
No. This is the way we connect database through Sqoop. This is not Java.
No, I mean. Yeah, but can this be done in any other way other than using Java?
No, I'm not getting the question, David.
There's a JDBC connector, right? So that means that you're probably using Java to do the...
Yes. It is built, the Sqoop utility is ultimately built in Java. That's why.
Okay. So this is back end internal of Sqoop.
Yes.
We don't have to do that.
Yes. So this type of command we are going to use in our practical as well. We'll provide all of the credentials like the driver and the table name to if we want to connect to, user ID and password. So we also have to provide the target directory on Hadoop in which we want to copy the data from MySQL to SDFS, the target directory. Now these are the arguments, the common arguments which I am talking about: connectable, username, password. So connect is used to specify the JDBC connection string, including the IP address and the port number, and connection manager, in which you have to specify the connection manager. These are the optional fields. I think connection manager is not always required. Then driver, we have to provide the JDBC driver class to use. Then minus password, this is the flag for password. Username and password both are from the relational database. Like in our example, it is a username and password of MySQL database and table, right? So these are some common arguments we can use with the Sqoop command. Now, if we talk about the imports, like if you want to import data from MySQL to HDFS, we can import data from table according table into Hadoop according to the query that we want to run on MySQL. Like suppose we want the table. We want data from one table where there is some condition met. So we can do the same thing with the help of query. So connect, we have to provide the connection string, and in query we can write select a table name from, and we can specify the condition. So only that data will going to be stored in HDFS. So this is called selective imports. We can do joins on database tables, preloading into the database. We can have multiple mappers. If primary key is not specified, then most of the processing take place in reducers basically. So this is the internal processor. We need not to worry about how it's going to be converted into maps and reduce. But we can do all those things which we can do at a relational databases. We can place where clause, we can place join in queries, right?
Yes.
We can do joining, we can do where. So this is very much similar to the code we are having in JDBC, in which we need not to worry about the internal implementation details, but we have to keep the JDBC API in our mind, that we have to code as per the specifications given in JDBC. So similar is the case in Sqoop as well. We need not to worry about the internal implementations, but we can write query as per the specifications of Sqoop. Right, David?
Yeah, Ashutosh, you said Sqoop is used only to convert from RD, from relational databases.
Yes, yes.
To Hadoop, mm-hmm. Right? So why would we use queries or like any SQL statements, why would you use them? Because this is not the work of Hive.
Yes. So Hive is not like a export kind of tool, David. We can do processing on certain data sets, but in this time we are exporting or importing data, transferring data from one of the component which is not present in the Hadoop ecosystem, right?
Okay.
Yes. So this is the case. And so since we are handling relational databases, that's why we write query.
Can you give me an example where you'd use a join?
Okay. So suppose we are like having two tables on the database, MySQL database, and we want some operation so that we can have one data set coming out from two tables, and we want to store that into HDFS. Then we want to use the joins. Like in example, you can see select A and A from table 1 and B from table 2, where there is some condition met. So only that record from both the tables I want to store in HDFS. So this is the processing before entering into HDFS. Understand?
Yes.
So if I want to have a data from different tables of one database, then I can write join, and whatever is the result of that join, I can feed that into LGSS.
Alright.
Yes. Then there will be one option file in Sqoop directory. When we like install Sqoop, we will have one option file in which we can write all the credentials which we are like providing during the Sqoop command, like the connection string, like username and password. We can have it saved in one file called option file. So the utility of having option file is that we can give the all the configuration related information into the file, and also there will be no change in the code once we deploy it, and we can do the changes only in configuration file. So basically this is very much similar to the configuration file we are having in Java kind of frameworks, like if you are aware about deployment descriptors in G2E. Yes. So this is the same file, like we can do the configuration in this, and whenever the Sqoop command will be issued, it will look into the configuration file for credentials and do the task accordingly. So whenever we want to change anything, like if we want to change the database, then we have to change in the option file only. Right?
Yes.
Then there are options to control the import process. Normally, when we do the imports, the target directory, the name of the target directory or SDFS is going to be same as the table name. By default, it will create one directory with the table name, but we can control the process. There are options. So by default, Sqoop will load data to a directory whose name is same as the parent table name. So suppose if we are firing a query on state table student, then there will be one directory on SDFS with the name student in which all the data will go. So Sqoop will load data to a directory whose name is same as the parent table, and the target directory created in the parent directory for user initiating the Sqoop command. So we can control the directory where the target directory is created, like we can give our name as well. We can overwrite the behavior, the default behavior, with the help of one command, one flag called where of directory, and we can specify the target directory name to store all the tables.
Okay. Right. Yes.
So there is an option by which we can control the import process. We can give the name to the target directory as per our convenience. We can give our own output file as well with delimiters. There are options for controlling import process. We can give names to directory corresponding to each table instead of making it same as the table name. Then basically, hello, yes,
yeah, I think your voice is breaking a little bit. Can you repeat the last sentence?
Talking about David, we can give names to directory corresponding to each table instead of making it same as the table name. So So that is the same thing which I was talking about. There are options to control the default behavior, right? Default import processes.
Yes.
Now, if we talk about data types which are there at the source data store, that is MySQL in our example, and the target in SGSS. So basically, Sqoop is pre-configured to map most of the SQL types to appropriate Java or Hive representative. But we can override this. There are options like we can map column like Java type of data type like a string to value with integer. We can append data to the output table directory with option append. So we can override the default behavior. We can convert the types as well. So this is something which we call ETL kind of process, which we have seen in Hive and Pig as well. We need to extract data from one of the data source. We have to provide some of the processing, that is transformation, and then we will load again data into some other data store. Extract, transform, and load. ETL. So ETL is basically a data warehousing concept. And there are tools available in the market on ETL. If you are like, if you have heard this term before, this is a completely separate discipline in information technology, software engineering area, data warehousing tools, in which there are ETL tools like Informatica, like Pentaho is one of the ETL tools. Oracle is having Oracle Data Integrator. All of these tools will have the same functionality to extract data from one of the data source, transformation, do some transformation, and load again into a separate data store or on the same data store as well.
Okay.
So this, we are doing the same thing using Hive, Pig, and Sqoop. We are extracting data from one of the data store, processing some kind of data, and again loading the data. So basically, Sqoop can be used directly to import data from RDBMS to Hive formats. We can export data from RDBMS and import data from RDBMS and we can convert it into Hive format. So for that, there is one command after.
By Hive format, you mean HDFS format?
Yes, by Hive format means I can use the load command for further processing. I can use load and dump and describe what we have seen in the previous session. So once I get the command in that format, I can do the operations with whatever I can do with the Hive. So this is nothing but changing the format according to the operation. Because see, After performing Hive operation, it will ultimately going to convert into MapReduce and then stored on Hadoop SGFS.
Okay.
So Hive format here means we can do Hive operations once we get the data in that format. We can perform load, we can perform describe, we can perform dump. So rest of the command will remain same, like Sqoop, import, then connection URL, then username from the table name from which we have to import data. And there is one more flag called Hive import. So by writing Hive import, we can do all the operations which we can do with Hive on that data. So like this, these are some Hive arguments we can use. Like in this example, we are having Hive import, which import table into Hive. That means we can perform Hive operation on that data, suppose load, describe, dump, and all. So I'll show you how we can do the Hive operations on this data. But this is one format. There is one more format called Edgebase, which we are about to start in one or two sessions later. Edgebase is one of the non-relational databases provided in a Hadoop ecosystem. So we can import our data from relational databases using Sqoop into the format appropriate for Edgebase. So for the moment, you have to just keep in mind that we can import data using Sqoop into a Edgebase corresponding format as well. So for the moment, we need not to worry about what is Edgebase and how it is used, but you have to just keep in mind that we can import data from relational databases using Sqoop into the format which we can use in Edgebase as well. So similarly, there are Edgebase arguments as we have in Hive arguments. Now it's time to have a look at the practicals. We can export data from HDFS to MySQL as well. Only difference will be the instead of writing Sqoop import, we will write a Sqoop export command, by which we can export data from Hadoop based systems to any kind of RDBMS again. So let's have a look at this is the PDF I already sent you, in which there is a description like Apache Sqoop is a tool designed for efficiently transferring bulk data between Apache Hadoop and any structured data store such as relational databases like Oracle, like MySQL or Teradata or anything like that. Now what Sqoop does, it allows data imports from external data stores. It facilitates us with parallel data transfer. It copies data quickly from external systems to Hadoop, and it makes data analysis much more efficient. So now it's time to have a look at the tutorial. So I think you are done with the MySQL setup on your machine.
Yes, I installed it.
Yes. So
I have the developer version, so that should be good enough.
Yes, there will be no problem. So now I request you to start the MySQL command line client so that we can log in into MySQL.
Okay, yeah.
Then we'll create one database. So David, I am making you the presenter so that we can proceed. Yes.
I can see the document though.
Okay. So do you have that document with you?
No, I don't.
Okay. I think you, I already sent email. Please check in your email. Did you get that? You have to create one database, like create database CVK.
Okay.
Create database. You can create a database with your name as well. Create database. Yes.
Okay. This is fine.
Create database. CVK. And just hit enter. Let's see.
And don't you need in?
Semicolon?
Line limiting.
Yeah. Yes, semicolon is required, yes. Okay. So query generated successfully. Now we have to make it as a default database. So we have to write use command. So write use cvk. So now we are having cvk as our default database. Now it's time to create one table, employee, with two columns, first name and last name, both will be where care.
Okay.
So create a table, employee. Yes. Employee spelling you have to write. Yes. Yes, done. Hit enter. Okay. So now we have to insert the values. So insert into command, insert into table name, that is employee, values, space values, and in bracket we have to provide the first name and last name.
With it.
Yes. So query is okay, two rows affected. Now try to see that using select command, select start from employee, what it will return.
Okay.
So we are having two rows, right? Now it's time to download the connector. Now we need MySQL connector so that we can connect HDFS and MySQL using Sqoop. Right? So now we need connector.
Yes.
MySQL connector. So please go to that URL, download the connector.
You provide the connector.
Sorry?
I said, who provides the connector? Who's providing the connector?
Okay, so basically the database vendors provide the database connector so that we can use their databases.
So, yeah, but like this seems to be like on Google Drive, right? So I think this is from MySQL.
Okay. So yes, it is provided, like we can get it from anywhere on the internet. Now there are so many places there are connectors, but officially they are provided by the manufacturer. Sorry? Yes, this is
not the official version.
This is the official version, but we are not having from that original URL, because sometimes yes, the website of official like got changed, and it will be very difficult for us to like have the correct one. So it's better to have all the tools available on the Google Drive so that we can have access to all at our ease. So now I think you have the database.
Okay, I understand.
Now you have the jar? Okay. Okay, good.
Yes.
So we are having the jar now. Now we have to move this jar to our Cloudera machine. So we have to transfer this. So we have to move the file or jar file to the Cloudera's distribution and the folder directory structure of Cloudera.
I'm pretty sure I can just copy and paste.
I don't think so, it will work.
So how do I do it then?
Yes, just a minute, David. Because we need to provide one way so that both our host machine and guest machine can communicate with each other. Because we have to move the data which is there on the host machine to the guest operating system.
That's right.
So what we can do, there is one option, I am not like able to recall that, but we can share one of our drives from our host machine to guest machine. So okay. Let me check David, just a minute, like what was the way, I just forgot how to share the drive. We are using what VMware, right?
Yes. Are you on the version number?
No, just
okay.
I will just try this, the URL on the chat window. I shared one URL on the chat window.
Okay.
But I think it will work on workstation, not on working machine. Are you able to find the same options in your machine, like VM, settings, options, share folder?
I don't see the idea.
No?
I have.
You have?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, I added it. You don't have to. Let's figure out how to use it.
No.
I was able to add it, but I don't know how to use it.
Okay.
I was able to copy paste it, Ashutosh. Ashutosh.
Okay. Yes, you are able? Okay. Good then.
Yeah. I mean,
so
I'm
just
able to paste it, yes.
Very good. Now we have to keep it on desktop so that we can have access to the part like home/cloudera/desktop and then jar.
Okay.
So now we have to copy it to /user_lib_sqoop_lib. So what we have to do, you can follow the PDF, same PDF again from this point of view.
Okay.
So now we are having our jar file on the home and then Cloudera and then desktop. Yes. Go below. Scroll down.
Okay.
Yes. So this is the command we have to write. Sudo cp. Okay, good. Now change the directory to Sqoop. Yes, we are having a Sqoop. Right, David. So far,
I don't see here.
What?
Oh, wait a minute. Okay, good. All right.
Yes. So now we are like on the place from where we can do now the connection. So first we need to understand the IP address of our machine, like of our host machine first. So just go to the host machine and try to run IP config. Yes. So note down the IP address, IPv4 address given below.
Rate of which, the host machine or the version?
Of the host machine. Of the host machine. That is something like 192.168.
Yes, 42. Okay.
Now we have to grant all of this, all privileges to this IP address.
Okay. Okay.
So in MySQL command line client, we have to write the command grant all privileges to root at the rate whatever IP address we have identified.
Okay.
Yes, David. Identified by root with grant option. It will provide all the privileges to the user on that IP address.
You have an error in your SQL syntax, check the manual that corresponding to your MySQL server version for the right syntax to the use near options at line 1 with grant options, right? Okay.
Wait.
Yes, good.
So now it's time to connect to the Sqoop utility using Sqoop. Now, as we have seen, for running Sqoop import command, we need certain credentials, right?
Yes.
We need the IP address. We need the database name. We need table name, username, and the output directory. So you have to write the command like sqoop import, and then we have to use the connect flag, and then while writing JDBC URL, we have to provide the IP address which we have now. The database name in our case is CVK, the table name is employee, username password is same as root, and the directory which we are going to use is sqoop out. I'll just write the same syntax given in the command bin/sqoop import. But
wait, this should be
in terminal.
Line of,
yes, in terminal.
This is IP address of
your machine.
Okay, yes.
Slash database name, in our case it is CVK.
That's right. What does minus M do?
It will indicate the mappers, corresponding mappers, the number of mappers we need. So M1 indicates that we need only one mapper corresponding to this Sqoop statement.
Okay.
It is asking about password, enter the password root. Oh. No, no manager for connect string, JDBC, MySQL, these. Connection for the get manager. Tool based Sqoop tool got error creating database manager. Let me check. Connection manager java.io exception no manager for connect string JDBC colon MySQL. David, just write the command again, like use the arrow key.
Yeah.
Bin sqoop import connect JDBC. I think after JDBC there is one colon, JDBC and MySQL, between JDBC and MySQL.
No,
there is.
Yeah, right.
retrieve two records. Good.
Yes.
So we are done with the import from relational databases to HDFS. Now it's time to check whether we are successfully like transferred or not. So for that we have to go to the browser and hit the URL localhost with port number 50070 and /dfshelp.jsp. So go to the browser.
What's the port?
Yes. Localhost colon 50070. 50070 /dfshelp data file system dfshelp distributed file system help dot jsp dfshelp dot jsp.
Okay.
Help H-E-A-L-P-H help.
Health?
Yes, health. So it will show the tabular format data. Yes. Now, when you click on the browse the file system option there on the above, so it browse the file system, the blue link.
Yes.
Click on that, browse the file system.
I did.
Yes. And now click on the Sqoop one directory which we have created. Sqoop out, yes. Yes. And click on path. Click on path. Path M.
Which one? Okay, we see it.
Yeah. So we got the data from MySQL database to our HDFS storage, right?
Yes.
So that's the way we can import data from any of the RDBMS. We have to just provide the connector, the driver part. And we have to do we have to write the statement as per the specification only. That's the only way we can like import data from RDBMS to HDFS. So you can try with a large data set as well in the same manner. And I